My name is Ken Simon. I am one of the librarians here, and as part of my job, several times a week sometimes, I stand in front of this classroom full of students who have been brought in by one of their instructors, and I teach them how to use our library resources. Usually those sessions are an hour and a half. We were scheduled only for an hour today. At the end of the hour, I'm going to beg those of you who can stay longer to stay a little bit longer. I'm not going to be able to run a full in-depth session the way I would love to do. If I had my druthers, right, we would have a series of meetings and go really in-depth. What I'm going to do instead is do something that's relatively brief, but that responds to what everyone here expressed to me in your registration form, which I'll actually show some of your responses in a moment. But first, what I'd like to do is just go around and have each of you introduce yourself, your name, and what area you're from on campus, just so we can all get a sense of where we're coming from here. Do you mind if I start with you?
Okay. My name is Edrina, and I'm from the Health Hygiene Department, and I do teach research class to second year health hygiene students. So
wonderful.
You're really helpful.
All right, thank you.
At the faculty in social sciences philosophy.
Philosophy, okay, great. All right, payroll.
I'm Dr. Brazier, I'm in natural sciences.
Natural sciences?
And I'm Susan Bauer, natural sciences also.
All right.
Mark Baker, natural sciences also. No, math, natural.
We keep rearranging. We're biology, environmental science, and your math, which you've been with us for down for a while now. So.
Is math an unnatural science? Well, this is actually exciting because, you know, by far the representation we get the most for classes who come in are English, speech, the College One students. So it's great to see people from other areas on campus. It's great to have people who are classified staff coming in. Students come up to us, they don't care if we're professors, you know, where we work on campus. They want information, they want help. And so hopefully what I'm going to show you can help you help students, but also you can use this information for yourself. I'm not going to rely heavily on PowerPoint. That's a drag, right? I'm going to do just a little bit to show you what we're up to today, and that will be the end of our PowerPoint, aside from the lovely welcome screen that you see there. This is, come on in, have a seat. Are you here for the MLA workshop or the faculty workshop?
The faculty.
Okay, great, come on in. Making sure we keep getting people coming in for MLA. So this is taken from your responses on the registration form. I've paraphrased, and there's one quote at the end that I liked. What you're here for, learn the basics on resources available to students for research, which databases to use for particular tasks, tips to help my students become better researchers, tools for me to be up to date on cutting edge research. So there's already a mixture of helping my students and also using these tools for myself, right? And this was the quote I liked. You'd be surprised at the questions our student workers ask and think that we know, right? So as I just said, we get approached all the time with all sorts of questions. I am going to hand out a sheet that goes over our objectives in a lot of detail, and you can use that to kind of structure your note taking. But just in brief, there are a bunch of objectives that we're going to sail through pretty quickly here. I want to make sure we leave this room knowing how to locate and select the research tools from our library that are appropriate for a particular topic or assignment. That we can each explain the concept of an article database to students who might not know what they are. We can show students how to find the library's research guides. We can use the talking to a database technique to find resources on any topic. This is a famous technique that I made up 4 days ago. I actually gave it a name. I never had a name for it, but it's what I do when I teach students. That all of you know how to request library research sessions for your students if you do teach classes. Okay, so that is what we're after today. I'm going to pass around, if you could start that around, that's our sort of objectives and a resource list, and then a sign-in sheet that's going around. Oops, I need a copy of the objectives too, so I know what I'm talking about today. That's my outline. Okay. So first of all, you know, this is something I tell students when they come in. I say that librarians love to use jargon, right? Just like professionals in every field, we get caught up in our jargon, and we go around talking about databases like it's second nature. And one of the things that I've heard librarians say to other librarians is, don't use the word databases, you'll scare the students. Well, I'm not in favor of coddling students and changing words so that as not to scare them. I'd much rather they understand the word and get comfortable with it. So one of the things I ask students to do when they come in is I say to them, forget about libraries for a minute. Who can tell me what is a database? And so I'm going to pose the same question to everyone here. Without thinking about libraries, what in its simplest terms is a database? A collection of information, right? Or a bunch of stuff that you put in one place, right? You break the word in half and you have it, database, like a home base for it. And so I tell the students, if I made a list of all of your shoe sizes and put it on the computer, I'd have myself a database. So the information, the stuff that's in library databases, well, those are the articles that you're supposed to find for your assignments, or sometimes videos, other things that are online. But essentially, it's just a place where you find the stuff you need, okay? So that's how I explain databases to students. And what I'm going to do now, if you do feel like following along on the computer, I put the login there, but it may not be necessary. I'm just going to quickly demonstrate a couple of things. From the library's homepage, and these things are all listed in the resource sheet you have, we have a link to our research databases. And if you haven't seen this or haven't seen it lately, it's changed in the last year. There's a brief video that explains how to use it, but since I'm the one narrating the video, I'll just do it live. You can narrow our list. We have 63 in our list now, a lot more than we had just a couple years ago.
63 databases.
63 databases. You can narrow this list by type. So if you're only looking for databases with news articles or video and film or ebooks, right, you can narrow it that way. And the other way you can narrow this list is by subject area. And this becomes really important because that's too many databases to sift through if you're just starting out, right? So, for example, if I wanted to look at biology, I could select biology. I've got some best bets, including, you know, our science full-text databases, health and medical databases, and then some others that also have biology content. But we segregate out some best bets as well. Okay, so one of the things that we all want to make sure our students know is that they can get to a short list of databases just by selecting a subject area. And then by reading the descriptions, it will really help them find what they need. We also, and I'll mention this in a little more depth in a few minutes, we also tend not to try and scare our students away from using the open web. And by that, I mean Google Scholar. If you haven't used that before, I'll do a briefly talk about it. Or even just regular vanilla Google. Of course, we toe the line about not using Wikipedia. But one thing that's really important for us as librarians is that when students leave school and are done and are out there in the world without access to some of these databases, that they can take their skills and apply them to search tools that they can still access, which is usually Google, right? So I just want to point that out, that we do not send the message here that you must always, always use our databases. Of course, for scholarly articles, they are the best bet, right? I'm going to open up one of our databases here. Okay. So how many of you, just by a show of hands, have used a database like this one? Does it look familiar? Most of you, some of you know. Okay, one of the things that I encourage students to use is this triple search box. Sometimes it's double, sometimes triple. It's the advanced search feature in a database. And you'll see in a minute why that really helps, okay? It's part of the talking to a database approach that we'll see in just a minute. I'm going to leave the database screen open and just show you one more path to databases and other information. I should briefly mention that this search box on our homepage, it's the only way to find books in our collection, which is not a search I'm talking about today. It has an article search, but it's actually not what we librarians are using and recommending to students. This search purports to search all of our databases in one great big lump. It does not do so very well, and it's very confusing to students. We're thinking about how to either change it or move it aside. Right now, we just steer students over here to our research guides. A lot of people don't know about these research guides. They used to be called LibGuides or LibGuides, if you've heard of them referred to that way. We have guides covering almost every subject area taught on campus. So even for students who do not come into the library, we want to make sure they know that they can find research advice and resources related to their topic. So just as an example, since we have people here from natural sciences, if I go to biology, here, we'll do this one. There's a guide on marine biology, right? Okay, this one's very specific. Some of our guides are designed in conjunction with faculty in that area. So you can tell a librarian who's not an expert would not know to divide the guide into these sections, blue crabs, green mussels. This was designed to go along with a course. Our more general guides look something like this. Like if you opened up our English guide, our speech guide, history, they all follow a pattern that looks like this. So a whole bunch of tabs, each tab is a page. Everything from beginning your research, which is going to be reference sources, searching through online encyclopedias, right? How to explore a topic and develop it. It takes students through finding books. There's that search box again. Finding articles. This list will depend on the subject area of the guide. Okay, we'll select a few databases to highlight. There'll be advice on finding websites. We don't often go through that in class because of time limitations, but it's there. There'll be some tips on research strategies. It reflects some of the things we do in class, but this is all intended for students to refer to afterwards or independently. We don't just read through this in class. Information about how to construct citations and why not to plagiarize, right? And then a tab all about how to get help from the library. Okay. Almost all of the guides follow that basic pattern. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to pull away from the computer for a minute. Oh, yeah.
This is stuff that you developed here, these pages, these guides?
Yes, the guides are developed in-house, right? And we love it when we develop them in conjunction with a faculty member in that area. So I'd actually encourage you, you know, if you're teaching in a certain area, go back and look at the guide we've created and see if there are things that you think we need to have that aren't there, or change anything you suggest, because they're always better when a subject specialist is there working with us. Okay, so I'm just going to step through what I do with students, and that is getting from an assignment, a basic topic, to an actual search in a database. This is how we do talking to a database, as you'll see. So let's just start. I used to, when I was a new librarian, have a practiced canned example where the searches all worked perfectly the first time. And that's so deceptive. It never works like that in real life. So instead, I take suggestions from the class and sink or swim along with everyone else. And that's what I'd like to do right now. Would anyone like to suggest a very basic, broad topic of research? Maybe something your class has to write about or you're interested in. Mm-hmm. Okay, great. Emotional intelligence. Okay, so one of the first things that I talk with students about, obviously I'm compressing this, is that if you just type this into Google or one of our article databases with its thousands of journals and magazines in them, it would be too much information, right? You could write a book, then there are books on emotional intelligence, right? So we need to be able to narrow it down to fit into our interests, whether it's our own research needs or whether it's an assignment, you know, to fit into that 5 or 10 page paper. So I encourage students to do a couple of things. One, is yes, to go out on the regular web, even visit Big Bad Wikipedia, not as a research source, but as a way of skimming articles to see what people are talking about related to their topic, right? What are some of the words that jump out? What are some of the ideas or concepts that jump out? Because we will take those ideas and use them to narrow down the subject, okay? And if students are really confused about how to narrow things down, we go through this. I ask students, what are the questions that journalists ask when they research a story? And what does anyone know what those five questions are? Mm-hmm.
Who, what?
Yeah. And the students all know these too, right? Who, what, where, when. There's also why and how, but for our purposes, I'm leaving it here. So I go through it with students, okay? First of all, maybe there's a population we're talking about, right? If we talked about emotional intelligence for the whole world, that would be a bit broad. Maybe we're talking about emotional intelligence based on a certain age group, teenagers, or based on a certain, depending on your topic, it could be, age, it could be a certain cultural group, religious group, it could be based on, and this ties into where, who and where are related, right? People who live in Southern California, are they less emotionally intelligent than people in New York? Something like that. That's a silly question, but you get the idea. That's one of the questions that people can ask. So we might be talking about I generally tell students when they're doing research here that if they don't specify the where, we're sort of doing a very generic US Western society kind of search, and that if their interests go outside of that, they really need to get specific in their search terms. The when also, unless students are writing something historical, unspecified the when is now or recent history, okay? If it's a certain time period, we need to list that here too. And I always save what for last. And what I say to students is, it's really tempting to say that we have our what. We're talking about emotional intelligence. So let's change this a little bit and change it to so what. So what? What about emotional intelligence is important? And I ask students to think about, well, how does that impact people? What effect, right? Words like impact, effect, how does that affect someone's life? So can anyone think of a way that emotional intelligence might have an effect on college students? Success, okay, great. All of a sudden we have three pieces to our puzzle, right? And what I tell students is, you can take these pieces and put them together in sort of an early version of a research question. What is the impact of the level of emotional intelligence on the success of college students? Put it together, break it apart, and you have your search terms, at least your first try at them. Okay, so after we've done that, and we often go into encyclopedia articles, there's a database called Gale Virtual Reference Library that takes the contents of, maybe it's now about 100 different encyclopedias on all topics. And you can search them by keyword. So we could find articles on emotional intelligence from education encyclopedias, psychology, sociology, right? All different perspectives. And they'd be short introductory encyclopedia articles that may help students figure out the so what. Okay, so once we get our three, usually I like three, three is the sweet spot, our three different pieces, the next step is brainstorming. And what I tell students is to sit down with a friend, a classmate, a family member, or plunk themselves down at a computer at thesaurus.com or something like that, and start to think of other words that are related to these. They'll often discover them as they find articles. So for example, is there another word when we talk about student success that is, that can be tied into that?
Achievement,
right? That's one. What do we measure here to determine if we're being successful?
Grades.
Well, grades, we look at grades. What's that?
Matriculation.
Matriculation, right? I'll just abbreviate that because I'm too lazy to write it. Or
graduation
graduation. There's one I'm trying to think of, and I just drew a blank all of a sudden. Not a retainment, retention, right? Retention rates. Or in community college transfer rate. There's all sorts of different measures of success, right? For college students, you might also have, you know, university students, right? Emotional intelligence, that's a concept that is what it is. I'm not going to mess around with finding other words for that. You could go into a psychology database and look for other related terms, though. So once we have all of our words done with brainstorming, I take the students into a database like this one. Okay, you know, a lot of our databases come from this company, EBSCOhost, and they tend to look the same, even though they're searching different sets of content. But we also have ProQuest databases. If you've been here a while, you'll remember we used to have them, they went away, they're back again. They look different. We have databases from Gale, they look different. But what I tell the students is once you've mastered one interface, you'll be able to look at another company's database and work your way through it based on what you already know with one of them. So I say, you know, look, isn't it convenient? We have three lines and three topics, and we can just put one topic in each line. Okay. Here comes talking to a database. This is the part where I try to make this make sense. If the three search boxes don't make sense to you, I say, let's ask the database a question. We're saying, hey, Academic Search Premier, out of your millions of articles, show me just the ones that mention emotional intelligence. Okay? So it's going to narrow down all those articles to just the ones that have that phrase somewhere in the title, the summary, maybe even the body of the whole article. But wait, that's not it. Out of those, okay, and it also has to mention college students. So now the article has to pass two tests to be in our list. It has to mention both of those things. But we're not done yet because it also, right, and the article has to have the word success in there somewhere. The article has to pass all three tests to show up in our list. Okay. So when I search, I find that 12 articles match all three searches, or all three terms, right? Look at this, the influence of emotional intelligence on academic progress. Progress, there's another word I can write under success, right? Another keyword. This one's in the UK, so we'd have to decide if we want to use that. So 12, okay. And then I talk to students about opening up the full text of the article, about how there are tools to email yourself an article. Every database has those tools. Once you're looking at an article, you just have to look around that screen. There's an email tool, right? There's a print tool. There's even a citation tool, but I warn students that if they rely on a database to create their citations will have errors in them. They don't work very well. Okay, so 12 results, that's great. Sometimes in front of a class, I'll get one result and it's junk. Sometimes I'll get an overwhelming number. But what we can do with 12 is say, well, this is great, but what if there's a great article out there that's talking about achievement instead of success, and we missed it because we don't have the word achievement? So let's take test number 3, right? Test meaning, hey, it has to pass that test to show up in our search results. And let's make it multiple choice. And we do that with the word or. And look at this. This particular database sees what other people have typed in the past. So I could also have it do or performance, but I'll just leave it the way it is, success or achievement. And when I run my search again, I've just added two articles that I would have missed otherwise, just because of the word achievement. If I string together all those words with or in between, I'd probably wind up with a lot more. The first search is never the last. Right? So if you get stuff that doesn't seem good, or one of your words is bringing up a bunch of irrelevant junk, take that word out. Change those words up. This isn't like Google, where that first screen of the 10 million results always seems to have what we want, right? Our standards are different when we're doing research. Okay. So, you know, this talking to a database where we're saying, hey, database, show me this and this. and this or this. I'm able to get students to reflect back to me that when we have and, we're narrowing things down, right? We're getting more and more specific, and that means fewer results, but more focused. And then I'm able to get students to reflect back to me that when we make it multiple choice with or, we're adding in another word. We're getting more articles, but in a focused way, right? We're not just indiscriminately expanding our results. And what I don't tell the students is that I've just taught them Boolean logic. Because if I start by saying, let's do Boolean logic, right? And it looks sort of like algebra when you write it on the board because you've got parentheses and it's a little bit daunting up front. Sure, there are ways to express this search on one line, right? Emotional intelligence and college students and parentheses, success or achievement. It's doable, but that's not friendly and it just adds complexity. That's why I tell students, advanced search makes it sound like it'll be harder, but advanced is easier when you're doing academic research. And this is why you can go from this to this. Okay, so just to show you what I mean, if I pull up a ProQuest database, and some of our ProQuest databases land you here in the basic search, so I just tell students, make sure you look for advanced. If you only have two lines, there's usually an option to add a third. There it is. And even though it looks different from EBSCO, you can still take what you did and adapt it to this interface. And I'll be the first to tell you that these database companies, they could use a little bit of improvement in their interface design. You know, like this one, they do the OR for you, except on the top line. There you have to type the OR. Why? I don't know. So they do make things complicated sometimes when they don't have to be. That's when I tell students, please, please, as soon as you feel like you're stuck in a database or in a search, talk to us in the library, right? We are available to help with just those kind of puzzles.
So how would they, if somebody is doing research, mm-hmm. how would they contact you?
I will show you a screen full of information on that in a few minutes, actually. And actually, I should mention, there. Just to do a quick search. In a lot of our databases, in the search results, we have embedded a chat box, and that's us. and when we are closed or busy, it defaults back to a network of librarians all over the world. So students can chat, ask questions, and then get an email transcript of the whole thing. It's very popular. There it is again in the EBSCO search results. Not all databases let us embed that. I'm going to stop here and ask if anyone else has any questions. I've been speeding along without stopping to ask. Yes?
So I'm one of those old timers that liked ProQuest when we had it.
Yes.
Never really embraced this EBSCO code. Mm-hmm. So you're saying now we have ProQuest again?
We do. So in that list of databases, that alphabetical list, let me go back and clear the list out. If I go to P for ProQuest, so there's ProQuest, the big general one. And just like Academic Search Premier from EBSCO, it's a mixture of magazines, newspapers, scholarly material on every topic. They have different content that only overlaps a little bit from the EBSCO one. So I would definitely bring this into the mix if you're used to telling students about EBSCO databases. I did separate out certain ProQuest topics because they seem to deserve a specialized search. So business, health and medical, psychology, and science and technology got their own separate subsections. But they all use that ProQuest interface. They'll look very similar to each other. So yes. EBSCO and ProQuest, neither is better than the other. People have their preferences just based on what they're used to, what they like the interface better for. But they both have a ton of relevant content, and it's different content. So if you're looking to do a thorough, exhaustive search for something, I recommend using both. And then we have a lot of other databases from other vendors that, you know, when you narrow down to your subject area, you'll see them listed, and you can explore those as well. Did I hear someone start to ask another question? No. Okay. Now this is something I'm going to throw in that I don't tell students about, but I really want you to know about it. I'll do one of them in EBSCO and one in ProQuest. At least one of you asked about saving a search so that you can be alerted to new articles that come out in your field. And I know that EBSCO and ProQuest will do this. I'm not as sure about some of the other companies, but we can always find out together if you want to know. With EBSCO, once you've done a search, right, I'll just use this one. Let's say that this is your area of research, and you want to know once a month if there's been anything new published that fits this search. They hide it very well, unfortunately. But see this share menu? The share menu, we librarians use it all the time because we'll send this link out to students. It takes them right to these search results. So if we're helping them, we can send them a link right to where we ended up. But there's this other thing here. Create an email alert or an RSS feed. I'm not going to get into RSS because it depends on how you read it, but email is the easiest one. You can specify how often you want to be alerted, right? In order to do that, you have to set up an account within EBSCOhost, and there's a little sign in. Do you see up in the blue area at the top? Sign in. You can create your account here and then create as many alerts as you want, and you'll get an email whenever there's something new that matches the search. ProQuest has the same thing. Whoops. I think it's here, yeah. Save search / alert, create alert, and it'll prompt you to create an account on their system. I know, accounts everywhere, but it is nice to just get these updates by email. So that's something we don't, yeah, yeah.
I had a question on EBSCOhost.
Sure.
You know, when I try to narrow things down for my students, mm-hmm. I use that timeline. So I, you know.
Oh, this?
They don't have as many hits.
Mm-hmm.
And then I ask them to use magazines sometimes as opposed to academic journals.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Here, let me run a search that'll have more results so we can look at this in another way. Okay. These narrowing features, we call them facets, but on the left in most databases, after you do a search, you know, they offer you all these different ways to narrow your results. So you just heard mentioning this date slider. These results go back to 1887. That's unusual, by the way. And up to 2016, you can change the date range. EBSCO's a little weird because they have a checkbox up here for scholarly peer-reviewed journals and a checkbox down here for academic journals. For the life of me, I don't know why they have them both. I always steer people to the one that says scholarly peer-reviewed. As for magazines, so you're saying that when you just choose magazines and it narrows things down, you're still seeing peer-reviewed articles?
Mm-hmm.
That say, I don't know. I've never encountered that before. Could I ask you a favor that the next time that happens to you, send me the search that you did because I want to see that. And if there's a problem, I'm going to tell them about it. I happen to be the database administrator for our databases. So when there's an issue, please let me know and I can yell at the, no. I can talk nicely to the vendors and get it fixed. I don't yell at them. Okay. Any other database questions before I move forward?
Do you have Medline?
We do. It's, yeah. I'm double checking to make sure I'm right. It's in EBSCOhost. Yeah. Okay. I mentioned before that we do not try to steer students away from things like Google Scholar. To be honest, in most sessions when students come in, we don't have time to go there, right? So it's not like we're actively telling students to bypass these databases and use Google Scholar. I wish we could teach students both all the time, though, because there's something they can use again when they're not enrolled here. And one thing I want to make sure that all of you know, if you're looking for a specific article and you have the name but you maybe don't know where it's published, or you just want a big broad search of a certain subject area, right? If you go to Google Scholar and you're at home, scholar.google.com, and you hit settings and then library links, there's a video that goes over all this. It's linked on the handout, so that's why I'm going fast through this. You can type Pasadena City College, make sure it's checked, and then when it knows your affiliation, it's going to do two things. Anything that's openly available will have a link off to the right that leads you directly to the article. These are just openly available from different websites. Anything in our collection will say Pasadena City College on the right, right? And you can just click that to get to it in our databases. So it circles you back around into our holdings. And you know, being a community college, there are a lot of advanced journals we don't have. So you'll see those listed without any links back to our holdings, but at least you know the article exists. And we have an interlibrary loan service. If you didn't know, just ask us about it. We can request articles that we don't own and have them sent over. Okay.
Down here at the bottom, yeah. Using Google Scholar, mm-hmm.
It's about a 2-minute YouTube video where I narrate the steps of setting it up to know you're at PCC and how to click through to a full article.
But if yeah. you do this at home, mm-hmm. you would do that at home.
Exactly, yeah. If you're on campus, Google Scholar figures out you're here and you don't need to tell it you're at PCC, so it automatically gives you these links. But when you're at home, it has no way to know, so you have to set it up. I should also mention, just in case some of you don't know, all of our databases are accessible off campus. They just require a Lancer Point ID when you're not here. That's how we keep out people who are not authorized. Okay. So let me go back here. What I'm going to do before I move on is, we don't have time to do this in full. I'm going to pass this out, though, to each of you. This is something that my colleague Dorothy Potter created, and I've taken to using it now. You know, I used to do in class what I've just done with all of you here, which is stand and talk and talk and talk. And we've all, you know, we all know that that's not the most desirable form of education, to stand and lecture the whole time. So what I do is I break students into groups, usually of four, and I hand this out to the groups. In the top where it says database name, I pick one of the databases that's good for whatever subject area their class is in, and I have the students take 10 minutes to answer the questions on this form. And I'm thinking of tweaking it a little bit for next year, but right now it's asking, you know, what stuff does this database have? What kinds of information? Can you limit your search to scholarly articles in this database? Some of our databases are all newspapers, right? You can't always do it. How do you get, there's another jargon, right? Full text articles. That's very confusing to a lot of students because there's two versions of full text. One is in the search box. A lot of databases, when you're doing advanced search, I don't think this one does it, instead of saying search anywhere, it'll say search full text. So students say, oh, well, I'm getting full text articles because I'm searching the full text of the articles. Thanks, databases, for making it confusing. Right, this, I don't talk to students about this very often. This is just specifying where you're searching, right? The author's name, the title of an article, or just generally find this keyword anywhere. The default is always keyword anywhere kind of settings. Anyway, full text just means show me the article, okay? So when it says how do you get full text articles, that just means how do you get that article up on your screen. Where are the tools to save, print, and email? And then the one I tell them to spend the most time on is describe at least one cool feature of the database. That's when I tell students not to be afraid to be nerdy about it, right? Databases can be cool. Just they don't have to admit it to their friends. But you know, to find something that I didn't talk about that database does. So students will do things. My favorite one that students discover on their own is in a database called JSTOR, which is an all-scholarly database. And students discover that once they've typed in their advanced search, they can scroll down and limit their search by field. So if they know that they're in a sociology class and they don't want psychology articles, you know, they want a certain approach, right? If they want to write about the environment from a scientific perspective and not from a policy perspective, whatever it is, they can check the field they're searching. And that's the number of journals in each field in this database. And their results will reflect that. And I don't teach that. Students have found that on their own. The great thing about this activity is we get to cover as a class many more databases than I would be able to do in an hour and a half or an hour and 15 minutes. And students realize that once they learned EBSCO, they can take that and learn any of our databases and figure out what makes them unique. And then they sort of become that class's, their class's expert on that database, right? So it, and students get more involved and more interested as soon as they realize they're finding things out for themselves and they're working in a group. It really helps keep things going. I encourage you, you know, if you have an assignment where your students would benefit from a session like the one we just had, but more tailored to students, definitely bring them in. There's a link on the handout for libraries' faculty services, including a form to request instruction. And as long as we have more than a couple weeks' notice, because we do get busy, we can set up a session and tailor it to your class, even tailor a page on a research guide just for your class. But if you don't bring your class in, and not everyone can or wants to, you can do an exercise like this one in class or assign it in pairs. You know, students can post it to Canvas, however you want to do it. And it just helps to get your students to teach themselves a little bit more about our resources. And that way, students who've already been here for English 1A or something can learn more databases. Yeah.
Can we use this form?
I don't see why not.
No,
you know,
I'm
going to say yes. In the library, we don't want to create anything proprietary. You know, I wouldn't equate these with things like syllabi where you really want to, you know, make sure it's okay before you just lift things. If you want to use one of our exercises in your class, I encourage it. Absolutely. That said, I still think it's best to bring your students in. Okay. Any questions about things I haven't covered up until now? Great. Okay. Let me go back to this and clear the results. I'm wondering if anybody here has a certain subject area that they'd like to, you know, to see what we have to offer before I leave this page. I do just want to point out that sometimes our databases go into areas where you wouldn't have necessarily guessed that we have content. We have an auto repair reference center, not just for students who are taking that as a course here, but for students who want that information for themselves, right? Things like that are there. If you haven't explored ArtStore, I recommend doing it even if you're, you know, not in the arts professionally. It's an image database that has just amazing, beautiful photography and artwork in it that is just worth exploring for fun. So there's all sorts of stuff. There's classical music library. You can stream classical music to your computer from this huge library of music anytime you want. So in addition to the research stuff, we just have cool stuff too. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
We have a lot of EBSCOhost.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sometimes I use one.
Right.
Did I use that one
before? Let me explain how that works. Okay. EBSCO and ProQuest are these companies, and they do things in a similar way. We get a package of databases from them. And we have the option of searching the entire thing lumped together, which has its advantages and disadvantages, right? When you're lumping in high-end medical and scientific articles along with today's newspaper articles, it's going to be a little bit broad. So we have the option of lumping it together or searching subsets, you know, their individual databases one at a time. With ProQuest, I mean, with EBSCO, before I was here, several years back, the librarians here decided to break it out into many different subsections or sub-databases. So that's why you have, say, science full text as part of EBSCO, and Academic Search Premier, which is a multidisciplinary database, a history one, auto repair, and then you have this EBSCOhost combined, which is everything lumped together, almost everything. I don't think it includes auto repair. So it can be very confusing, and we've gone back and forth on how to handle that. I added the combined thing just a couple weeks ago to try and help clarify that. It's the same with ProQuest, but we decided not to subdivide ProQuest quite as much. So that's why I did subdivide things like health and medical, but there were a lot of smaller subdivisions of like easy newspaper articles, advanced magazine articles, you know, just things we didn't want to break apart. It would be too much, too granular. So that's where that's where the big ProQuest everything search comes in. ProQuest and EBSCO are the only databases where that happens. All the other things we have are from vendors where we just have one or two products, and it's much more clear cut. So does that answer your question? Okay. Thanks. That was a good question. The last thing I want to make sure that I show everyone is that from our homepage there is Ask a Librarian. And you know, what I tell students is chat is a great second choice. To be honest, I don't love our chat service because when it's not one of us, the quality of the help varies. Sometimes you get a librarian who's really on the ball, and sometimes you get someone who, I don't know why they're handling chats. Usually it's good. So I still tell students to use it, but the first choice is always come to us in person. Because we're always here when the library is open, and just being face to face with a shared computer, you can really work through things much more effectively. But just so you know, and so your students know, you know, phone calls are for quick questions, but we also will answer questions by email. And the dirty secret of the email is that they all go directly to me, just me. So when students email on Friday night, I really want people to understand it's one work day. Sometimes I give in and I answer on the weekends, but I'm not going to promise that, right? So I'm thinking of rewording this to clarify, but I do during the week strive to get an answer that day or the next morning. If it's a very complicated, in-depth question, I will encourage a visit, but we'll help in any way that's good for the student, really. And for your own research, I keep saying the student, this is for you too. I mean, this is not just limited to students. We will help you too. Come to our desk, chat us, email us, anything. That's what we're here for.
Typically, how many emails do you get a week?
It depends. At the beginning of the semester, it's slow. Not hundreds. I'd say at the most five a week, because we don't push that very much. Most of our questions come through chat or up at the reference desk. A lot of schools report that the visits to the reference desk are dropping off because everyone's online all the time and not coming in. And we've seen just a little dip, but we're still really busy at the reference desk a lot of the time. So, chat too. Okay, I'm just looking to make sure that I didn't skip anything that I wanted to go over. What I'm going to do after this session in the next day or two is I'm going to send out a very short survey just to get a sense of you know, what you got out of this today, if there are follow-up questions. But I encourage you to hold on to this sheet for all the resources and links that it provides. If you want to work with one of us on creating or adapt or modifying a research guide or having your class come in, please just talk to me, talk to any of us here at the library, and we're more than happy to work with you on that. So also be on the lookout, because I think it's still happening. Next week, there's a second session that one of my colleagues will be doing with me on how to incorporate information literacy into the assignments that you create. Okay? If it doesn't end up happening this semester, it will happen in the fall, but I think it's happening next week. An announcement will go out. So thank you for coming. I really appreciate it. Yeah.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. Concerning copyright issues.
Yeah.
Like you mentioned, for the ARC mm-hmm. database.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Databases that are more, I mean, there's Creative Commons, but is there anything that the library has that's
mm-hmm.
more open access?
By the nature of the fact that they're subscription databases, most of the content in our databases are under one form of copyright or another. Mm-hmm. There are, for example, with art and images, there are Creative Commons searches on the open web that I will show people how to use. But I know in Art Store, each image has a little statement about the rights that are associated with that image. Most databases don't do that. It's the art one that does.
Yeah, I was just wondering if there was more out there besides Creative Commons.
Mm-hmm. Oh, besides Creative Commons?
Yeah, a database specifically mm-hmm. for open.
And do you mean with images specifically or articles?
Yeah.
You know, there's a movement toward that. And there is something, I'm trying to remember the name, I think it's called the Open Access Button. And it's a plugin for web browsers. And when you use that button, I believe it will try to find whatever you're looking for in an open access version. I have to brush up on this. It was a couple years ago that I last saw it. So we're not really teaching them here, but they're out there and they're growing. And I'm sort of happy about, I am happy about that, yeah. Anything else? Okay, well, thank you for coming in today. I appreciate that you took the time, and you know how to find me. If you have follow-up questions, please do. Okay. Take care.